By way of introduction to this morning's worship service, I would like to read to you something that the National Association of Congregational Christian Churches put out about the church. And I'll begin reading now. The shift in choice of words from "I go to church" to "we are the church" implies some very different ways of thinking and then behaving. Most of us in North America have grown up with an understanding of the church as a building or a place where certain things happen in a predictable fashion and at certain times. Participation in the life of the church involves going to that place and participating in certain activities. The dominant experience has been that of a voluntary association, organized and run by professional clergy. While laity may be involved in certain aspects, in most of our experience, the primary responsibility for the ministry of the church has rested with the professionally trained clergy, the pastor or the pastoral leader. There exists a clear and definite set of tasks that everyone, even those not involved with the church, knows are clerical duties. The problem is that such a division can overlook the giftedness of the whole community, stimulate passivity, and restrict the scope and power of the church's ministry. This has served to reinforce assumptions and patterns of participation that find us going to church to receive the services provided by the trained few. Instead, the church is, in reality, a gifted Christian community that is called and sent. It is a community where commitment, accountability, trust, openness, long-term relationships, and sacrifice are the standards that guide its life together. And so, in this worship service, instead of hearing a sermon from me, you'll be hearing from many members of our congregation telling you about Bible verses or hymns that have inspired them in their Christian journey, in their faith journey. They are the church.
Hi, I'm Jan Johnson, and my favorite Bible verse is Isaiah 54:13. It says, "All thy children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children." And as a mom, I think that's a wonderful promise from God, and it's kind of been my life verse for the past 35 years.
Good morning. I just want to share with you one of my favorite prayers that we have done in Bible study for the last few years. It's from the Battle Plan for Prayer, and I really think it resonates with everything that's going on in today's world. Father in heaven, I pray for my brothers and my sisters, praising your name for them, asking you to fill their hearts with worship for you today. Help them to honor your name above themselves. May their primary desire always be to advance your kingdom wherever they happen to be, whatever they happen to be doing. May they align themselves on the earth with your will, just as surely as your will is followed and accomplished in heaven. Provide them, I pray, with their daily bread, with everything you know is required for them to thrive and be cared for, and grant them repentance, forgiving them of their sins, even as you forgive me of mine, while also keeping the relationships free from bitterness and difficulty as they forgive those who sinned against them. Please, Lord, protect them from temptation, from allowing them to be overloaded with adversity, and deliver them from all evil, from every scheme and attack of the enemy, and from every weapon intended to defeat and discourage them. For yours, Lord, is the kingdom, the power, the glory forever. You reign and rule, and have already given them victory through the finished work of Christ. So I pray for them today, and I pray in his name. Amen. May you have a blessed day today.
In his book, 100 Most Influential People in the World, Michael H. Hart lists St. Paul as the sixth most influential person in world history for his contributions to the spreading of Christianity throughout the world. Paul's writings dominate the New Testament, with his letter to the Romans being arguably his best and most insightful and relevant. The passage from Romans 12, 3 through 8 is scripture I first read in college as pledging a fraternity with a brotherhood of Christian young men. In it, Paul tells the Romans that healthy self-esteem is important. It is important to know the basis of our self-worth, our identity in Christ. Paul is writing to the Romans, and in a different time, it's as if he were writing to us here at Third Church. Each of us brings a diverse talent to our church community. When you can identify your own personal gifts, ask how you can use them to build up God's family. Let your strengths balance others' weaknesses, and be grateful that others' abilities make up for our deficiencies. Together we build Christ's church. From Romans 12, 3 through 8, Paul writes, "For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, and not all the members here have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually, we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry in ministry. The teacher in teaching. The exhorter in exhortation. The giver in generosity. The leader in diligence. The compassionate in cheerfulness." The hymn I chose to include, "Let All Things Now Live In," has nothing to do with Paul or the Romans, but it is a Welsh hymn, part of my heritage, and it has a catchy melody that I learned as a teenager at camp.
Morning. My segment today is based on a message of hope to all mankind. Man has always been conflicted throughout history, and with that he has expressed that confliction through art as a way to voice concern and to encourage peace. Today, I will perform a musical selection entitled "An American Tune," written by Paul Simon in the mid-70s. What makes the text so poignant is that the words have just as much meaning today as they did 45 years ago when he first wrote the song. The original melody is taken from an old hymn entitled "O Sacred Head Now Wounded" by Hans Leo Hassler. The original text relates to Jesus Christ's suffering and death. The melody is haunting and beautiful. The melody was later harmonized by J.S. Bach in his St. Matthew Passion. Paul Simon, again, took that beautiful melody and reworked it into his own style and added new text. The lyrics express concern for America and the American dream. He writes, "When I think of the road we're traveling on, I wonder what's gone wrong. The American dream comes with both disappointment and loss. Each generation endures its sins and crisis. But it is the hope that we will forge ahead toward a brighter day." So I'll first play the original melody so that when I play the other selection for you, you'll hopefully hear the influence. Okay, so this is the original hymn tune. Thank you. And now I'll perform Paul Simon's An American Tune.
Many is the time I've been mistaken, and many times confused. Yes, and I've often felt forsaken, and certainly misused. Oh, but I'm all right, I'm all right, I'm just weary to my bones. Say, don't expect to be bright and bubble, so far away from home, so far away from home. I don't know a soul who's not driven to his knees. Oh, but it's all right, it's all right, it's all right, for we live so well, so long. Still, when I think of the road we'll travel, but I wonder what's gone wrong. And I dreamed I was dying. I dreamed that my soul rose unexpectedly, looking back down at me, smiling reassuringly. High up above, my eyes could clearly see the Statue of Liberty sailing away to sea. Dream was flying. We come on a ship they call the Mayflower. We come on a ship they sail. Ages most uncertain hours, and sing an American tune. Oh, it's all right, it's all right, it's all right. You can be forever blessed. Still, tomorrow's gonna be another. That's all I'm trying to get some rest.
The Bible passage I have chosen is one that has always had a special meaning to me. I first heard Psalm 23 when I was a child attending Sunday school. It has always stayed with me every time I hear or read it. The feeling of comfort, strength, and faith are renewed. I also get the feeling that the Lord is always there by my side, watching and protecting me while I travel the journey of my life. This is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the home of the Lord forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Please join me at home as I sing the first three verses of Holy God, We Praise Thy Name, number 2 in the hymnal, and the first verse of Now Thank We All Our God, number 788 in the hymnal. Holy God, we praise Thy name. Lord of all, we bow before Thee. All on earth Thy scepter claim, all in heaven above adore Thee. Infinite Thy vast domain, everlasting is Thy reign. Hark the glad celestial hymn, angel choirs above are raising, cherubim and seraphim in unceasing chorus praising, fill the heavens with sweet accord. Holy, holy, holy Lord. Holy Father, Holy Son, Holy Spirit, three we name Thee, while in essence only one, undivided God, we claim Thee. And adoring bend the knee, while we sing our praise to Thee.
In Romans 8:18, it's written, "The pain that you've been feeling cannot compare to the joy that is coming." There have been many times in my life where I've felt that this passage was written for me, maybe even about me, considering all the hardships I've had to endure. But if my faith has taught me one thing, it's that when I'm faced with an obstacle, I just need to stop, take a look inside, and I can find the ability to look beyond the challenge I've been given and see it for the reward it offers. I was incredibly young when my parents got divorced. It ended a marriage that was tainted with alcoholism and violence. The experience was very hard to process at a tender age of 6, and it absolutely left me scarred for life. But at the same time, it opened both of my parents up to later marry their true soulmates and who they were supposed to be with. I have been blessed with my father's wife, who has been an ally and become a surrogate mother to me, especially since the passing of my own mother, as well as providing my children with even more support and love by the way of grandparents that they otherwise wouldn't share in their lives and make memories with. As a child, I was also relentlessly bullied. I was name-called, I was pushed. I had my class photo used to replace a character on a Don't Play With Germs campaign poster that was distributed to the entire class. I spent many lunchtimes in the office or in my teacher's classroom to avoid sitting alone while being pointed and laughed at. I shed an incredible number of tears, but with wiping those tears, I've been able to recognize a true friend when I see one and be able to form trusted friendships that has lasted me decades. Friends who have seen me through personal loss, illness, more illness, and many more things, but they continue to value the positive attributes they saw in me when we first met. Friends who have been the first to hold my newborn son, held my hand at my mother's memorial service, watched me walk down the aisle when I married my soulmate. They have been there to wipe my tears as I prepped for yet another surgery, and friends who've trusted me to help raise their children. When I was young, I married and divorced a person who didn't properly value me or the vows we took. Pain that at the time seemed unbearable, yet led me down the road I needed to travel to meet that soulmate of mine, Chris. He has shown me genuine love and continues to stand by my side through everything that life has thrown at us together. He's loved me and cared for me in times I couldn't even care for myself. The family that I gained with him has been paramount in my learning to love myself despite years of uncertainty and insecurity, providing me with yet another mother and a father chosen for me by God to turn to in the times of sadness as well as joy. I have a support system that understands and loves me and everyone of that family, even at my worst. Together with my soulmate and husband, we've mourned the loss of two very much wanted souls in the form of unborn children. But that also allowed us to be gifted with two children who were destined to fill our lives and hearts with love beyond compare. With each of the many involved medical diagnoses that I've encountered came a strengthening of my faith in God and my gratitude for his ability to see me through them stronger than before. Every one of my experiences is something I have chosen to see as a building block in my foundation that I needed to build the house that I call my faith now. I have been blessed to live in this house of faith, and it has brought me a peace and joy that I wish for every one of God's sons and daughters, every one of you. Just as in Romans 8:18, the truth, the pain that you've been feeling can't compare to the joy that's coming, is a truth that I pray that you all experience. Thank you.
Good morning. I hope you are all well today. I'd like to talk about the Bible. You know, that book, that's the best-selling book of all time, the B-I-B-L-E. Like you may have sung in Sunday school, the B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. Well, the Bible is full of messages of hope. And it's the best-selling book of all time. You've probably heard that. Hope is what we need right now. Hope in a lot of different ways, for a lot of different things, for a lot of different people. The Bible is full of lessons and examples and stories. Lessons of caring for those less fortunate than us. Lessons for and rules for living well. It tells us not to steal, not to kill, not to hurt our neighbor in any way, but help with his or her physical needs. Not to lie, not to betray, and to treat others as you would want to be treated yourself. And most of all, to love one another. A friend of mine calls it the basic instructions before leaving Earth. B-I-B-L-E. Basic instructions before leaving Earth. I found a hymn that I would like to share with you that is not in our congregational hymnal. And it's written by David Haas in 1988. It's called Come Live in the Light. We are called.
Thank you. I have chosen one of my favorite scripture readings, Hebrews 11:6. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Some quotes relating to faith. Faith is not the belief that God will give you what you want. It is knowing that God will give you what you need in the right place and time. Faith is not without worry or care, but faith is fear that has said a prayer. How do I build my faith throughout the days? I say prayers throughout the day. I read the Bible some days. I read a spiritual devotion every morning. I listen to positive and encouraging music. I continue to be involved in church. Worship God with a thankful heart every Sunday. Make friends with people who share my own values. I've attended several Bible studies over the years to learn about God's teaching. I've served as a deacon for several years, which is a spiritual leadership, and I also am on many committees at the church. I try to be a leader of the church, which is also part of being a deacon, someone who people feel comfortable speaking with. I do the church Facebook page. I post daily positive spiritual quotes, as well as do all the advertising for our church events on the Facebook page, as well as in the newspapers. In my own life, I've had several things that strengthen my faith, both in health and personal life. And I believe my faith is stronger each day. And faith is not something that you can physically see or touch, but you believe in your heart and you know that God is always there. So it's something that you believe in. And I believe in God, and his strength for me has always been strong. One of my favorite songs is Great is Thy Faithfulness. If you have a chance to look up the lyrics to that song, you'll see for yourself a little bit about your own faith. And I'd like to close with this quote. Having God in your boat doesn't mean that you're not face any storms. It means that no storm can sink your boat. Walk in faith and you'll never walk alone.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the faith and the work of the fathers who raised us in hope. We praise you for the work that our fathers have done in and out of the home, and we ask you to bless their work to fruitfulness. Lord, give us faith in a future we cannot see, a future being formed at the depths of our lives, a future in which the good deeds of our fathers come to fruition and the sins of our fathers are forgiven and corrected. Lord, bless each of us with forgiving and hope-filled hearts. Make us slow to judge. Make us slow to anger. Grant us a grace that enlarges future goodness, enlarges the possibility for positive change in our country, especially now as we confront the injustices of our past. Let us listen to those whose life stories have gone unheard. Let us hear the cries of pain, and let us work for justice with patience. We thank you, creative God, for those whose work sustains the community in which we live. We thank you for those who grow and provide our food, for farmers and laborers in the fields, for those who fix tractors and those who sell fertilizer, for those who drive trucks, crunch numbers, place orders, stock shelves, and scan our groceries. Teach us to remember that all our lives and our way of living depend upon the work of many minds and hands, both people we have never seen and those we know very well. Grant us the grace to do our jobs well and trust that doing them conscientiously matters, even when we cannot see immediate results in the lives of others. Lord, there are places in our lives where we do not know what to do or say. There are crises we are not prepared for. We lift our prayers to you now, not as substitutes for words and actions, but as ways of sowing seeds of hope for the future. Let us pray silently and with hope for the better future we envision. Lord, quiet our eagerness to explain, to rationalize, to defend our mistakes, our errors, and our sins. Let them come before us clearly in the light of your eternal love. Reassure us that we were never created to do it all right or to do it all alone. As you are with us always, so send us helpers, teachers, challengers, preachers, comforters, and friends. While it is more blessed to give than to receive, once in a while, let someone else be more blessed as we relax and receive love, encouragement, and support. On this Father's Day, we pray for fathers who grew up without good role models and are struggling to be good fathers to their own children. Let them be the kinds of fathers they never knew. Let them become great fathers. Answer their prayers. On this Father's Day, we pray for children who have lost their fathers. We pray for all who miss their dads. Send good men into their lives to bridge the gaps and fill the voids. Loving God, we have brought to you in prayer those whom we love, knowing that your love for them is so much greater than ours. So guard them in your keeping, O Lord, and give them now and always your richest blessing, even as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I decided to sing this song, Let There Be Peace on Earth, because of all the unrest in the world today.
Let this be my song.